Right? Or can we just call them pastor? Better to call them student pastors because that is what who they are at this point. You can call them by their first name. But whatever you do, do not call them pastors in training. It was Pastor Charlie that told me this. Pastors in training. The pit. Okay. Well, I'm gonna. This is Ben and Student Pastor Ben. So you can address them as SP, Student Pastor Ben, or Ben. And this morning we have Student Pastor Ben co-chairing with Elijah this morning. I'm going to hand this time over to them.
Thanks, Pastor Chris. So yes, I am not Pit Ben. It's just Ben. And this morning it's just so good to be able to worship with all of you, to be here. Well, this morning, both Elijah and myself, we are your chairman for this at this camp. And you know, looking at Elijah, looking at myself, we actually would never have thought that we will be co-chairman like this in such a situation. How do we land ourselves in such a situation? We don't know.
When I got the news that I would be sharing with Student Pastor Ben, I was really intimidated. Naturally, student pastor, going to be a pastor. But when I told him that, he said he's still the same Ben that he was before. So that brought a lot of calm to my heart. You know, I really thank God for this bond of friendship that we can have. And it's shared in the IPC family. Every time I've traveled to Singapore for youth conferences, you know, there has never been a moment where I haven't been shown care and concern by the brethren in Bethany. You know, an example of this was when Ben was 22 years old, which is the age that I am now, he wrote me a letter. A very long one, as you can see, and words so small. Don't know why he writes so small. But
small in size, that's why it's small in methods as well.
And this was before conference started. So before I even left to go to Singapore, I got this letter from Singapore to Perth, and it was just to get in touch with me so that I would know someone on the other side and be familiar with someone at least. You know, it's from these small touches that, you know, I've remembered it, I kept it, because it really shows that love and joy that we receive when we go to Bethany.
Well, can you imagine? This letter was written 7 years ago. I'm not that old. I'm still quite young. But it's so good to see that even after 7 years, this is where we are today, that we can lead and worship together. We can still remain friends. But most importantly, we can serve God in the same IPC family. You know, I remember how Bethel was to me, and Bethel is to me, when I came in 2013. 2013 was the first time I came to Bethel. I did not just come to visit, I came to stay in Bethel. Thank you for all the hospitality, Pastor Chris and Aldine. They were actually quite worried that I was alone here in church. So they got people to stay with me, to accompany me, and they got two big guys to follow me. One is Tim, the other one is Enoch. I think he was very afraid that I was feeling very unsafe in church. But after these two came to join me, I felt very safe and very happy, of course. And they followed me everywhere I went. So they were like two bodyguards. Which Singaporean has two bodyguards in Perth? Well, I had that experience. You know, it's so wonderful. As I looked at them, I was so impressed also by how they could walk out in T-shirts in the cold. So I also tried. I also went walking in T-shirts in the cold. But when I went back home, I think I felt a bit sick after that. No, but it's so wonderful, really, to know that we can experience love, care, support, wherever we may be, whether it is in Singapore, whether it is in Perth. But actually, when we look at all of this, as we reflect, as we seek to understand what makes us come together, what holds us together, more than just people, more than just memories for that matter. It is really this idea of the Word of God that stands out so much more. And this is our commitment to the Word of God, that as we hold fast to the Word of God, we remain as one IPC family that is there. And the Word of God is something that we are committed to even as we commence camp, even as we begin camp. And you know, as we read last night, Deuteronomy 4, we understand that it is through God's Word that He speaks to us. Well, this morning, as we begin a fresh day at camp, may our hearts also be prepared, be ready to receive God's Word, that even as we receive God's Word, we can listen and understand what God is saying to us. So even as we begin today, let us share our first song with you, Speak, O Lord. And as we sing this song, may this be our prayer, that as we read the Word of God, may our prayer be that God, You speak to us. Help us understand You, help us understand Your truth so much more. Let's sing this song together, Speak, O Lord.
Thank you for your singing. As we know, the theme for our camp is taken from Psalm 119, verse 11, which reads, Your word I have hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against You. Pastor Chris challenged the committee, the camp committee, to read Psalm 119 in preparation for camp. You know, in reading through Psalm 119, specifically the first few verses, the psalmist speaks of the state of his heart in an honest and real way. You know, this was a servant of God who openly confessed to who he really was. And it helped me to identify that I needed to do the same thing, to be honest with myself. And the truth is, I came to the conclusion that I wasn't actually hiding God's word in my heart. And I didn't want to think that I had strayed from God. I wanted to put it aside. You know, there was an event or an experience that really showed where I had gone astray. And that was my grandpa's passing 2 months ago. So 4 months ago, my grandpa was admitted into hospital, and it was from then on that his health declined. The doctors approached the family to choose quality of life or quantity of life, and our family decided to stop the treatment. So this meant that Grandpa would either be put into hospice care, which is he would stay at a facility where nurses would attend to him, or we would have the decision to take him home. And that decision would mean that someone in the family would have to be there for him at all hours of the day. So we took that option, and we wanted to take care of him. But along the way, things got hard. You know, it started to become difficult when we had to decide who would take care of him and on what days and how many hours it would take. And this is where a lot of bitterness and resentment came into my heart. And it caused me to sin against God. It was these family tensions that really took my heart's focus away from where it should have been, which is in His Word. Instead, I dwelt on the wrong things. I dwelt on that resentment, and it really caused me to sin against God. I definitely wasn't keeping His Word in my heart. This is why this camp is so crucial to me. I need to know, I really, really need to know what it means for my heart to hide God's word. I need to know how this word in my heart can make me draw closer to Him. And it is from this verse, and this verse alone, that I want to be committed to hiding His word in my heart. That I would not dwell on the things that would take me away from Him. The second song that we're singing today is Change My Heart, O God. A renewed heart is in a person who hides the Lord's word. And this is honestly what I'm seeking for at this camp. I need to be renewed in my heart. And I'm really, really thankful that we have this opportunity to listen to God's word on this topic, because I know I need it. So with this, let's sing this song, Change My Heart, O God.
Well, thank you, Elijah. Now, even as we hear Elijah speak, we recognize for both Elijah and myself that we share honestly as people, not that we are perfect, but we do struggle. We really do. You know, the verse before verse 11, verse 10, Psalm 119, verse 10, it stands out to me. Let me read it for you. With my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Now, as I read this verse spoke very much to me. Because in this verse, the problem of wandering is highlighted. And I read this verse, I saw how the psalmist wrote of this verse, and I recognize that this problem of wandering is a problem of my own. Problem of wandering, it's so easy. It's so easy to wander. It's so easy to wander from God's commandments. And this was my problem. You see, I am prone to wander. Yeah, even as a little child, I am prone to wander. I wouldn't follow my parents well. Even when they brought me out to go to different places, I would wander from them, and then I would get lost. I would not follow their direction. One time I went overseas in an amusement park in Gold Coast. Was walking around, they said, stick close. But I wandered, and I got lost. And my parents were so afraid. They thought that their child had been kidnapped by overseas, and they were so scared. And I had to be picked up from the security because I got found at the security center. You know, even in Singapore, when I travel on the roads, I would get lost because my sense of direction is not very good. And I wander, I miss road signs, and I end up getting lost. But what if this is more than just a physical problem of wandering? What if it's actually a deep spiritual problem that is there? And I looked at this verse, and I recognized that this problem was my problem. You see, I could hear the word of God even as a younger person. I would be encouraged. I would be even inspired. Challenge, let me do this. But when I reach home, when I go out with my friends, when I go back to the world, this would be lost. I'll be detracted from what I originally was challenged to do. Even as a young person, even as I served, you know, I was involved in many activities. But deep inside, my heart was not there. What happened to my heart? You see, it had wandered. And there were many ups and downs, but sadly, more downs than there were ups. And many times, I ended up being very spiritually dry. And all because my heart had wandered. You know, what really made a difference? You know, before I became a student pastor, I would meet with pastor on Friday mornings, some Friday mornings at least, and one meeting with him really impacted me very, very much. You see, we just read this simple verse, Romans 1:1. Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ. And he shared with me. You see, Ben, you know, many people have asked me before, have you ever considered any other career options besides a pastor? And he says that probably, and they added that you probably would do quite well, given, you know, your skill sets and so and so forth. And he asked me, what do you think? Do you think I would make it outside if I was not the pastor? And I say, well, I don't know. I mean, obviously, perhaps yes. But he said no. His response was a really strong affirmative no. Because this was what he knew he was called to do. And he wanted to be obedient. He sought to be obedient. He said, I'm not going to wander from God's ways. I'm going to stick close. I'm going to stick true. And this is the path that I will follow. I will seek the Lord with the whole heart that is there. And this is what it means to be obedient. Just like Paul said, I am a bond servant to Jesus Christ. And I looked at his example, and I am deeply moved. Deeply, deeply moved. Deeply convicted as I looked at his example, because I too wanted to be obedient. Enough of wandering. Enough of going astray. Let me follow the Lord. Let me be obedient. Let me stay true to God's commandments. You know, after that meeting, it was also because of that meeting that I began to really consider, and it became a deep conviction of mine that one day I wanted to serve in the ministry as well. You know, today, even as I serve in the ministry, even as I serve as a student pastor, the problem of wandering is something that does not easily go away. But what is my answer? You know, I fight against this problem of wandering. In prayer, I humbly pray to the Lord, please, do not forsake me. Help me keep close to you. I pray for a cleansed heart. I pray for renewal. I pray for revival. You know, on my part, I'm committed to driven and committed to seek the Lord so much more. To find the drive to really draw near to God, to hide God's word in my heart, that I will not forget your word. And so I'd like to share the next song with you. And this song is meaningful to me, because in the third verse we read, it's a prayer that even the songwriter writes, this last part that is there. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. But what is his answer? It is this humble prayer. Here's my heart, Lord. Take it, seal it, bind it for your courts above. And may this be all our prayers as well, that we can learn what it means to seek so much more our Father in heaven, God who has given us so much. And may this be our prayer. May this be your prayer even as you sing this song. Let us sing this song. Come, thou fount of every blessing. Let's sing. Thank you. We hand over the time to Pastor.
I really hope that you will follow through with what you all are sharing about wanting to seek God in your life. And I really mean it. Hoping that you will begin, and perhaps the Lord will speak to your heart, and you can really, really start. Is it possible for a young person to read, understand God's word from a very young age? Actually, yes. This is my testimony. God gave to me a love for his word that has continued for 50 years. And am I tired of it? Not really. Do I understand everything? Not really. I just know one or two more things than Pastor Chris. And I want to share with you those one or two more things. Every day, one or two more things. So after 1 year, it's 600 over more things. You just multiply, but there's so much to learn, discover. I really hope you will be challenged. Okay? So more than just giving you a lecture on how to study God's word, I want to share with you openly, honestly. Now, the poems that I've written actually reflect the spirit of the psalmist. See, when you want to become a poet, you have to be true and honest to whatever you're writing or trying to interpret. Okay? You have to be founded on truth. This is his spirit, and I want to try and capture his spirit. I have no business trying to say what it does not say, because that would be wrong. right? And so he's very honest, very open. And so some of the poems are going to be pretty hard-hitting. But only because the psalmist was like that. I mean, he was honest with himself. I hope you all understand what I'm trying to get at. Okay? Well, let's begin in prayer together. Our Father, we pray that you would open our understanding. Help us to really grapple with the true state of our heart. And we pray that you will help us to understand your word a little bit better after this hour. And be challenged to pursue further. We pray for your blessings on all who are here. And we pray that you will continue to do a great work within our hearts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I begin with this poem here on this. This is taken from the first segment. Okay, now, this is a really, really open statement you need to. It's really taken from this verse, Psalm 119. And it says, "Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes." Right? Well, let's take a look at these things here over here. I need to help you to understand some of these things here. So this is, here we go. These are the thoughts which actually come from this first 8 verses. That some lives are greatly blessed by God is beyond doubt. That's why he said, blessed are the undefiled in the way. Right? This is obvious. They are so blessed. Obviously so. These walk in God's ways. They do not merely walk about. See, a lot of you Australians walk about. You go down there, walk about, and then don't know where you disappear to, and then they come back 6 months later. It's called walk about. What's the point? This is a bit Australian. Huh? Their lives are clean and clear from the snares of evil sin. Their souls reflect the cleansing work of God from within. A candid check on our heart would reveal the true state of our life. We often lack the peace of God, but instead are troubled by strife. The heart knows that our ways are not directed to keep the law of God. We declare we have faith, but we do not really walk with the Lord. The heart must ponder and be deeply convinced we need to mend our ways, or we will always have deep turmoil within us and we could end up in disgrace. We prove ourselves inconsistent and we've hurt the good name of the Lord. And all because we have not directed our hearts to keep the laws of God. The heart must yearn to walk in the ways of God in paths of sanctification. The word of God must feed our souls or there would be no transformation. The lives that are blessed are filled with purpose and strength and power. These dear servants of God have learned to seek God in that sacred vow. Remember what the Lord said? When you want to pray, go to your little room. I call that a bower. And that's a place. So if you don't spend much time and it's overgrown with weeds, then you know that you're not walking with the Lord. So you've got to ask yourself, have you found a place where you really spend time with God? And most people don't, unfortunately. Some people think that I can be spiritual without the Word of God. The answer is no. You can't. Because that is God's plan. The Word of God has to be there. And if it is not there, you are not spiritual. Forget about it. Don't kid yourself. A lot of people think that I can just bypass the Word of God. You're bypassing a roadmap. Where's Netherlands? Is it up there or the other side? Without a roadmap, you can go in and drive for hours and the other tank is empty. You still can't find a place. You need this roadmap. You can't. You cannot say, well, I'm instinctive. So where's Netherlands? You don't know what you don't have the map. You can't get there. And yet, we just think we can do without God's word. Now, I feel. Knowing God is not about feeling. Understanding God is not about, I think. See, a lot of times we've been taught wrongly. And these things, unfortunately, affect us and control us. That is the problem. Okay, now I want to introduce to you Psalm 119. And this is a beautiful psalm, but you have to understand the nature of Psalm 119. Otherwise, you can't get it. Psalm 119 is not about stories. Stories, you read Kings, Samuel, Gospels, Acts. You don't read stories from Psalm 119. Okay? It's this part of it called the wisdom literature. Right? So this is important for us to understand what this is. This is called wisdom literature. What on earth is that? So without this wisdom, that's why the book of Jeremiah, the people said, we are wise, we don't need God. And the Lord said, how can you be wise if you don't know my word? Now that is the whole part of it here. God's plan for us is that one day we ought to be wise. There are only two types of people in this earth. Wise, otherwise. So you're either wise or you are otherwise. That's it. So if we don't have the Lord's word, guess where you belong? Otherwise. No matter how we look at it. So this is absolutely important. Now the features of this psalms, in this particular psalm anyway, is actually observations of life. Right? Let's look at 119. I'll show you what it's all about. Take a look. Okay? So in verse 1 and 2, this is not a pronouncement of blessing. This is an observation of life. And Psalm 119 is like that. It's about observing life. You know, in life you observe, you know, you see a lot of things, you learn a lot of things, you learn about life, you learn about yourself just by observing. I think that's what he meant. So he observed this thing. He said, you know, there's some people who are blessed. That's why the first time. You know, that some are blessed is without, this is really beyond doubt. Look at their lives and you will see this very, very clearly. Right? Now, we take for example, they are undefiled in the way. Some people get caught up with life sins. Some people are undefiled. But how come they are undefiled? How come they know how to be undefiled? Well, the reason is very obvious. They walk in the law of the Lord. That's why they are undefiled. You want to see a person who is not walking in the Lord? Very obvious. See their lives. They're not walking with the Lord. No matter what they say, no matter what they try to do. Right? So this is where observation. Blessed are they. Twice he makes this observation. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies. And so they are those blessed, obviously, and those who are not. So this is actually observations. And then, after I observe, what lessons am I learning from observation? No point observing and not learning. Well, I'm observing, but I'm not learning. How does that work? It doesn't work. And so the book of Psalms, and book Psalm 119, there are many, many little words, statements. And they're just like the book of Proverbs. That's why it's called wisdom literature. That's why you can pick one particular verse and out comes a psalm, or out comes a poem. Why? Because the poems are actually inside that verse. It's just asking to be said. So what do? I find the words and I say it. That's it. And by the way, there are other people who write poems. Camille writes good poems. And Ben Kwa writes good poems. And really, and I mean it, and they write it. They are not so free as I am, you see. So they are too busy, so I'm a bit free, so I write poems. But seriously, Seriously, I mean, it's just where we understand the Word of God. It's there. It's just a poetry part of it. Okay? Now, some of the Psalms are prayers. Some of the Psalms are praise. Some of the Psalms are personal things. Psalm 119, all three. Part prayer, part praise, part personal expressions. Unmistakable. Right? You see, so my poems are committed to the same thing. Because if I want to be true to the psalmist, I have to watch these things here. Is there a prayer? Is there a praise? Is there a personal expression? And so all the poems you read, you say, wow, it's always heart-beating. Why? Because the psalmist is sharing very candid, personal, frank thoughts. Well, that's how to read this Psalm 119. Now, Psalm 119 is special in more ways than one. Now, on top of all the Psalms, you'll have this word, and word Aleph, you have the word Date, you have the word Gimel, and so on and so forth. All these things are actually what we call the Hebrew letter, the Hebrew's alphabet. This is how it is. So they are written the other way around. So this is the Aleph, this is the Bet, this is the Gimel. And all the, every psalm, every stanza, 8 verses, right? And you begin to look at it very, very carefully, and they're all the same. You start with Aleph, next one begin with Bet, next one begin with Gimel, and this is possible. But it would require quite a bit of skill to be able to do this. So obviously Psalm 119 is written by a person who is open, who is honest, who wants to be spiritual, who is also very talented. Writing poetry doesn't just come. You feel like it, you put anyhow what words you want. Sometimes people try to send me poetry and I try to tell them very kindly, you know, God has not given you this gift. It is a pain trying to read your poetry because you can't write. And some people want to write sonnets. And so some people, you see, they're all different forms of writing. And they're very, very precise. So it's a skill. And this person has developed this skill. And marvelously so. Now, I'm not going to do it in Hebrew, so no point. Okay, but just let you observe some of these things here. Okay, take for example, 3 things we want to do when we read Psalms. Psalm 119. First, we observe. Second, we interpret. Third, we apply. You must have these 3 things which are there. Okay? If you read your own thoughts into the scriptures, you're not reading the scriptures, you're reading yourself. You're reading your own thoughts. That's not how to read scripture at any time. Some people read a word and yes, I believe this, and off they go. You're not reading the scriptures. God's not speaking to you, you're talking to yourself. Okay? So this is how to read the scriptures, and a lot of people haven't learned how to do that. They say, well, I believe this. I don't care what you believe. If it's not what God says, what you believe means nothing. Right? So this is important that we need to understand. So be careful. So if you have got dreams in the middle of the night, chances are you might want to check what you ate for supper. That doesn't mean that God has spoken to you. Okay? You could be having a nightmare. So this is important for us to understand. Right? So we watch. Let me observe this. Let me try to interpret it. Let me see whether I can apply it. 3 things. 1, 2, 3. And if I don't do this, then I would not learn the discipline of noting what the Word of God says. Okay? Application. Now this is important here. And all these things. The observations are there. It's up to you. Train yourself. See. Interpretation. A bit more challenging. It involves principles. It means you've got to check. You've got to bear in mind the context, right? And you've got to compare spiritual with spiritual. And this is where the Holy Spirit will enlighten. And if he doesn't enlighten, no matter what you study, nothing comes out. So that is the nature of the Lord's Word. Okay, if you really want to read it, can I do it? The answer is yes. But you're going to do it God's way. You want to do it your way, you are going to end up reading your own thoughts into it, and it's not going to help. Application must be personal, it must be prayerful, and you have to follow through determinedly. Okay? So if you don't pursue to the very end, you're not going to make it. So if I begin a journey, I may not conclude it. If I want to start, I want to finish. Many people are starters. Very few are good finishers. I like to finish something I do. Right? No point writing a poem halfway. What's the end of the story? It's terrible to read the book and then halfway it stops. And that's really, really, really bad. Okay? Sometimes my wife wants to say, you know, I want to watch a video with me. So she tapes it. And she said, come, sit down and watch with me. And then it doesn't end. Oh, that is the worst thing. And if it ends, you say, look, we made it. Can you imagine seeing a movie and then it doesn't end? You don't know what's the end of the story. What happened? Did the butler do it? You've got to know the end. Don't tell her that. But she knows. I will tell her that I said that. Okay, but this is something you want to appreciate. You want to start, you want to finish. Okay, but this is important. I really hope, you know, these guys have given up their profession. You want to start, you want to finish. You want to stop and wait. Here, we burn our bridges, there's no going back. That's it. And this is what we want to do. Okay, think about this thing here. All right, now, let's try to take a look at this very, very catchy issue. And you'll find this throughout the entire Psalm. 22 sections. Right? 176 verses. The theme for every segment, 22 times over, it has to do with the Word of God. Now that tells you something. That really tells you something. And yet, a lot of people, they read the Word of God and they say, I already know it. The moment they say that, all I know is the fellow doesn't know it. That is, it's so rich a thing that you want to study. Okay? So we look, take a look at his observations, and you want to take a look very, 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 very carefully. Right? Let's look at it now, and then later on, we go into discussion along the way. Right? Let's take a look at this. And I tell you, this person is very, very honest with himself. So he observed. Some people are blessed. Okay, now watch this, okay? In life, we observe, obviously. One day, there was a lady who was sick. The American lady went to be sick and asked her husband, okay, you go to church today, they tell me what you see. So the husband went dutifully, and so she asked, what did Mrs. Smith wear today? I don't know. What about Mrs. Black? What did she wear today? I don't know. You know? Then she asked a few other people. She asked him, what are you going to church for? What are you observing? Now this is important, right? In Perth, if you see 888 in a car plate, I know Chinese. Nobody else would you Chinese, okay? You like that? Sure, 888 Chinese. Obviously, right? Or some of the others, they were gonna put themselves. You know, this person says, I know Indian. Put that pretty. You can tell. You observe, obviously. Nothing wrong with these things here, but you can observe and you can tell. That's what it is. And he observed and he knew. These people are blessed. Look at their lives. They're not caught up in sin. They watch this. Look at this observation. Look, 119. Look at verse 1. Blessed are the undefiled in the way. You watch their lives. Right? Blessed are they. And you see something particular, something peculiar about these people, and they are so blessed. What are these things here? Obviously. Of course, the book of Deuteronomy tells us where the blessing is. And God promises that they will not be the tail, they will be the head. God promised you will be blessed above everybody else. Obviously. Why not? God's desire is to bless. The problem is sometimes we look at ourselves. Okay, now watch this. And every one of them blessed. The key factor is the Word of God. Why are they so blessed? Now take a look, and we see this very clearly. Okay? They walk in the law of the Lord. They keep His testimonies. They seek Him with the whole heart. Unmistakable. These people are so blessed by God because you watch their life, they are undefiled. You watch them, they seek God with the whole heart. You watch them, they keep His testimonies. And that is the reason why they're blessed. There is a difference between I have the mercies of God and blessed. Sometimes students tell me, you know, I didn't study very hard, but then God gave me an A. And they say, I'm blessed. Oh, no, you're not. You just observe, you obtain the mercies of God. You deserve to fail. But God helped you to pass. That is a blessing? No. That is a mercy. But if I have done my part and I really enjoy what I am doing and I do well, that is a blessing. That's a lot of difference between a mercy and a blessing. And people don't realize that actually they have experienced the mercy of God, not a blessing. Blessing is different. I have a friend who goes to university and went to the seminary with me. To him, he begins his day, another A. I mean, seriously. Another day, another A. That's how he sees his life. He's got 7 degrees behind his name to prove it. Literally. And everyone, he said, he's a really good observation. Right? So we see this blessing. What is this? And we see this very, very, very clearly. What is it all about? Now, take a look at this very carefully, okay? Now, then he related, remember? Compare. How did it? You have commanded us to keep your testimonies. Okay, so this is observation. These people under the blessed segment. Are there people who are not blessed? Actually, yes. Take a look. Go on further a little bit. Okay? And you see this very, very clearly. Verse 21, for example. You rebuke the proud, the cursed, who stray from your commandments. Now, there we go. So these are the blessed, and these are the cursed. Typical features. They are full of themselves. They're proud. They don't realize that they are in trouble with God. They're arrogant. I've got it all. I'm clever, I'm talented, I'm smart, I'm nice. Really, I've got it all. They don't realize that they're cursed. And look at this. And they stray from God's commandments. How can they be? See, sometimes you can be, you saw somebody was writing, I saw a big, nice poster. And it says, I'm so far behind, I'm first. Right? Nobody's running, you know the fellow who runs in front, he's first, nobody's following. This one is so far behind, he thinks he's first. There are people, they don't even know that the Lord has not blessed them. There is a difference between being blessed and being healed. That is a difference. Right? Now, who is doing all the blessing? Actually, God. And this is God, and this He has given us a straight commandment. Right? And commandment chapter 4, Deuteronomy. I hope you read, took a bit of time last night, this morning. Read Deuteronomy. And you will begin to realize, God, you have given us commandment to keep your testimonies. Right? And then here comes that wake up call. Wake up. And this is what he said. All that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Now that is a really great challenge. Okay? And so this is the point for this morning. Right? Some lives are greatly blessed. Right? The fact is, we got to ask ourselves, are we consistent? Are we really seeking to walk in it? Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. You see, the problem is we don't. That is the problem. We don't. So here we are. Either this or that. We don't realize it. We always think we're in between. If you want to jump from one cliff to another, one jump, you cannot take a second leap. So you either cross it, or I'll try again, you are stepping on air, you die, you sink. In life, you either make it or you don't. Either you're saved or you're not. Either you're blessed or you are here, because you like it or not. Unfortunately, we keep on thinking, oh, I got money means I'm blessed. No, you just got money. Money and blessing are not the same. And I've seen a lot of people who are happy. One day I was walking in a shopping center. And a man looked at me and he says, can I talk to you? I said, sure. Can I ask you a question? I don't know him. He doesn't know me. I am the anchor tenant of this entire shopping complex. I'm the anchor tenant. I will tell you, I'm a very rich man. I don't know why he told me that. Is he really boasting about his wealth or what? But he says something, I'll ask you one question, okay? Why do you look so peaceful and happy and I'm not? He looked at me, I don't think you are as rich as I am. You are right. I don't know why he told me that. But he said, you have something I don't have. What is it that makes you so peaceful? You walk happy, you know anything, you don't care. He's got worries. He's angered him. Every month his rental is 70,000. He's got to make that money to pay this. That's a lot of money to pay back. Then he's got staff. Add another 30,000. That's 100,000 every month. And he's got to generate that income. If he doesn't, he's going to be in serious trouble. No wonder he worries. Right? So I've got a family. I've got children. I have everything. Am I blessed? No. I just have physical things. Physical things doesn't mean less. I mean, this is important. Unfortunately. unfortunately, many people think that they are so blessed. So we get them. This is a blessing. You watch the Lord's life. Blessing, the promise of life, the blessing for the babies is so singularly different. Right? And if he looked at himself, oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. And I like his expression. I really do. Watch what he says. Okay? Oh, that my ways. See, many of us don't realize this. It's not my words. A lot of people talk words. Words are cheap. They're worth very little. You want to check whether you are really walking in God's way? Watch your ways. Not words. Ways. What's your way of life? This can you. So if I go to church, okay, I have a one way Sunday I go to church. Fine. One way. This is not one way. This is ways. And every way is directed. That is a person who walks in God's ways. Okay? One day there was a man who, you know, he was saying a prayer to God, and he said, God, you know, when I started out very little, I only earned $1,000. You know, I can easily, happily give $100 every month, no problem. Now, Lord, I earn literally $100,000 a month. It's very hard to write $10,000 check. So God said to him, I can bring you back to $1,000. You see, what are our ways? Unfortunately, we think that going to church on a Sunday is the way. No, it's not. There are many, many roads we walk on in life. Donald Trump, you know what's the problem? Everybody says he doesn't pray. His foreign minister appointed doesn't know where Turkey is. Unfortunately. Right, here we go. Now his advisors would be his daughter and his son-in-law. It's not a family business. Why are we serious? 50 states, family business. The children are rich like anything. Ethically, you cannot be involved. You know, a couple of $100 million and they will be billionaires. That's how rich they are, the children. Not talking about themselves. Are we talking about seriously? What are your ways? You know, I like to think of our ways, for example. Okay? Going to church is one day. What do I do with Monday to Saturday? What is my way? Thought life. Have you ever thought of a thought life? A lot of people don't have a thought life. Nothing feeds the mind. The mind stays stagnant, is still. It hasn't grown, it hasn't matured, it hasn't developed, it's worth very little thought life than my ways. You know, this is important. So one day, just a couple of days ago, I have a little daughter. No, not so little anymore, she's just taller than me now. And she said to me, I was driving her to school and she said, I just came across a very nice estate. Very nice condominium. Every apartment here is a million plus. And so many homes hang their underwear outside. You can take a person from the kampung. Very hard to take the kampung from the life. Still kampung mentality. Unfortunately. I mean, this is how it is. You know, in Singapore, there is a very special way of eating by the local people. I could never do that. You sit there, you don't look at the stool, you squat on the stool. You cannot squat, not a good place to eat. And they eat and they spit all over the place. And after his lunch, he goes down there and whistles. And out comes a Mercedes with a driver to pick him. And there he is. Can't believe this. I saw this with my own eyes. In Singapore, we've got this little district called Sungai Road. They call it a thieves market. The government is trying to close it down. A lot of people are protesting. You know, you cannot close us down. This is a thieves market. You know, they sell wires especially. I'm gonna try and see whether it's good or no good. So I bought a pair of jeans. And it says made in America. Oh, I'm not bad. I was doing a junior camp, took them out one day for an outing, playing with them. And then suddenly I heard a sound. At the wrong place. Let's go home. What was made in America? Only the sun. Nothing else was there. It was just useless stuff. And it was new. It was the first time I wore it. And it just, on the outside, you know, from far nice. Far from nice. And that was what it was. What the word? Are we committed? I mean, seriously, what's our thought life like? What's our speech life like? And you know, you can go into all sorts of things and you can end up wrong. So look at this guy in Sungai Road. He was bargaining with a fellow. He wear a pair of shorts, wear a singlet, you know, pair of shorts, wear a pair of slippers, singlet. And didn't comb his hair very rough. Look at him, man. He was bargaining with him. I said, oh, this fellow must be maybe small time businessman, you know, bargaining, so that he can sell it somewhere for a better rate. So after he bargained until the last 20 cents, well, he took 20 minutes, he just went, okay, he collected it. He said, okay, where? Just sit here. Walk to the road. Oi! Mercedes 280 came along. Hey, where's the murder? Shorts, singlet, slippers, and he bargained into the last 20 cents. You see, you can't take the bit out of it. What are your ways like? And old ways don't die easily, they die hard. The challenge is, am I really saved? Am I really a child of God? Am I really a servant of God? Everything about me will change. How I think, how I speak, how I live, how I serve, all my ways. The problem is that we think, I go to church, I serve, I'm okay. No, you're not. If you're honest with yourself, you know you are not. That's what it is. Unfortunately, you can convince yourself. You know, when I was a kid, I'm actually not very good at this Chin Chow drink, this blood jelly thing. There's something about it that I take, it triggers of asthma. So I tell myself, I like the thing, because not because it's good, but because it put a lot of sugar inside. You know, when you're a kid, you know, wow, anything that's sugary is great. There it was. So I tell myself, you know, I know it's cold, but I should keep it warm in my mouth. Then when I drink it, I will be all right. Then I will tell myself again, no, I don't take a full cup, just half a cup. That's it. And I tell myself I'll be okay. And every time I take it, I will trigger a lesson. See, my thought was wrong. My reasoning was wrong. My reaction was wrong. My taking it up, I'm just asking for it. Do you want to know whether you are really right in your ways? So let's say, well, you know, God has spoken to me, you really want to improve. And you say, I shall now be. And you think, if I start now, I'll finish. Wrong. Your ways will have to be directed. Your mind, your heart, your spirit, your attitude, your ways, you're going to give up something. So if you are a TV addict, you know, in Myanmar, they used not to have TV. Now they have a TV. A lot of the children, sons, go to Singapore to work, and then they send back money. Now they can buy TV. And the worst possible thing, they like Korean drama. And they can see the Korean drama until they go crazy. 10 o'clock service. He asked the pastor, can change time now? Because it clashes with my TV. I haven't got a video yet. Not yet. One day say to their video, not yet. But they have TV now. There's a craze that people watch. You know the stuff in Myanmar where the people are poor? I ask them, how do you survive? You eat only once, one meal a day. How do you survive? He says, I pay $1. I go to my friend's house, EPL on, whole day can see. When you watch it, drink water, don't feel hungry. That's how they survive. One way. No, all the ways, all that my ways will direct you. You cannot just change habit, one habit. You're going to change the whole person. And if you don't change the whole person, I'll tell you something, nothing will happen. Oh, I ask God for forgiveness. Nothing will happen. You are still the same person. Really want to walk? You change a bit. This is a company, I will never walk back. You're no longer my friend. Until you see it, it's very hard to change ways. See, you can go to jail, okay, today I'll make it. But it's a Monday to Saturday, that's a problem. So he recognizes, God, you have commanded us to keep us, keep your statutes. What's my response? These are blessed. Am I? I'm not. That's why he was very honest with himself. I am not. You know, this was a prayer. All that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. That's the way to read God's word. I read it with a desire to have my mind, to have my heart, to have my spirit, to have my ways, to have my very way of life changed. And if they're not, nothing will happen. That's why a lot of people read Bible and then they say, I don't know, I cannot get anything out of it. You see, you know, sometimes, you know, when we are sick, have you seen people when we are sick? The mouth cannot taste anything. Not good. Nothing is good. But it's done the same way. It's not the food, it's you. You have lost that taste in your mouth. And that's the problem. You know that there are over 5,000 taste buds in the tongue itself. And once it is affected, you, it's gone. Sense of smell, gone, it's gone. And that is a real problem. Right? So this is something that we need to look at very, very carefully. Now, go on further. Okay? And then he said, then I would not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments. I think most of us do that. You read it, you feel shame. I have not done this, I have not kept this, I have not read. Hey, you know it! All the commandments, the Lord, this, that, I've not done this. What's the point? You know, the joke is old in the US. They say, you know, the person broke the IRS and the income tax, revenue, and he says, I'm sending you this as, back payment for all the things I should have paid. And then he says, if I feel any more guilty, I'll send you some more tax. Doesn't work. It really doesn't work. You either fully do it or forget it. You cannot just simply go to a shower and say, the water is there, the soap is there, the towel is there, and look at it and feel clean. Not going to happen. Oh, I'll turn on the water then. Not going to happen until you get through. Until you are truly, fully washed. Not until. And that's how it is. Either it's old way of forgetting. This is not going to happen. Right? And this is something that we need to consider. We go on further. Otherwise, the sense of shame will be there. When I look into your commandments, it's going to happen. The shame will be there. Then what will happen? When we really feel really blessed by the Lord, what will happen there if we understand it? And you can see it very clearly when the person is blessed. He didn't say how the person was blessed. But towards the last part of it, you begin to understand what he meant. Okay? One, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Okay? Verse 5. What will happen then? See, that is consequential. As a result, as a consequence, then I will not be ashamed when I look into your commandments. You know why people go read, don't want to read the Bible? Because they read and they feel condemned. They feel guilty. I don't want to read. I already know it. Because they read and say, oh boy, I know. Ashamed. But if he really keeps his way, now watch what happens here. Okay? Then he says, I will praise you with uprightness of heart. Not because you have a voice. I will praise you. My heart is now upright. See, my ways. So when the heart is not upright, the sound, the singing is really pathetic. And I think this is something that we want to get. What is it? Uprightness of heart. That's what it is. Okay, when I learn your righteous judgments. At the end of it all, you know what? I will keep your statutes. Well, that is how it goes. How great a danger was he in? Very great danger. God could have forsaken him utterly. You see, people don't realize that this is the cursed part of it. What is the last straw cast aside? Do not cast me away after me. This is the apostate part. The person does not, he realizes this. This is why the psalmist prayed. Do not take away your Holy Spirit from me. Don't want to end up being cast away. And that's what a lot of people don't realize. They are just, God's not using them anymore. God can't use them anymore. Unfortunately. See, that's what we don't want to end up. And he realizes. So this is the blessed. This is a curse. This is God. This is His Word. Now you have to choose here or here. You want to choose here, you cannot say, my heart is here, but my feet goes elsewhere. Doesn't work. If I want to be there, heart, mind, spirit, whole being, I am here. You cannot, well, you know, I'd like to follow you, but it doesn't go. That's why people fail. People fail in their lives because they don't realize how serious about it. How serious can it be? Here, don't cast me away after me. That is the danger. We are just that close to being set aside. That's how dangerous it can be. Right? You know, I work with this thought of mine. God can easily, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, here, plus one young lady. And one day, God will tell me, okay, step aside. Take over, and I am casting it. Can it happen? I pray now. But no one is ever safe from this. Right? So I recognize there are so many people who are obviously blessed. You get aware of blessing. I will praise you. Look at the life of the person. Look at the lips of the person. Look at the praise that comes forth of the person. The other one, lies, deception, cunning, anger, bitterness. That person is not blessed. The person survived by the mercy of God. That's it. You only know one person is blessed, but look at the life of the person. It's full of joy, oil of gladness, praise. Obviously, there is that life, unmistakable. Joy to be in a person's presence and company. The other one, ugh, who wants to be there? You want to know your best? Yes, yes. A lot of people, very few people have this. I will praise you with an opera heart. Very few people. Right? I know there's a blind tenor. This fellow is very, very famous, and he has a beautiful voice. He's a tenor, and he sings beautifully. And one day he was invited to Singapore to sing, actually. And, a mutual friend, I couldn't go to that concert because he was on a Saturday, and I don't give up Saturday or anything. It's ministry day. So he was there. Well, I heard a recording about me, you know, I can tell you this. He doesn't know the word. You cannot sing any hymns because real praise will come from a heart that is upright. That's how it works. But I've seen people, you know, every time they go, America's Got Talent and things like that, they become first, second winner and things like that, and they cut records. And at Christmas time, you always ask them to sing Christmas songs. And you listen, and you know. This person doesn't know the word. How do you know? Because this kind of praise can only come from a heart that is upright. And only the upright can truly sing songs of Zion to the Lord. Nobody else can. Is Bethel there yet? No. You have yet to learn how to really sing. And it's not the hands, it's not the organs, it's the heart. Let's be challenged to be there truly blessed. You watch. Let the praise be there in the heart. The heart must be upright, not talented. We have many who are talented. Recently, we had this one person who came to know the Lord. Just very recently, last year. And when he came to know the Lord, you know, he never felt he needed the Lord. He's a very successful person. He's a director of several companies. You know, and then when he came to know the Lord, we discovered that he's a very talented oboist. Now he plays with the church. You hear him play and you know he knows the Lord. You know, he will come and he will do it. He will practice. He will ask this practical because my wife plays organ. So she says, well, can I practice with you? And he will start practicing for hours. Actually, it's a concert that I always. And all he wants to do is to just praise God. It's nothing about himself at all. That is how that works. Praise comes. You see, it's not praise. It's the righteous heart, the upright heart. That's what God wants to do. When we read his word, he wants to affect our mind, our heart, our spirit, our attitude, our ways. So if our ways are not touched and changed, then be sure you're not reading the Lord's word properly. Anybody can say, I'm sorry. My way changed? Still the same. You haven't changed. You can tell. The spirit of the person is so obvious. This is something you want to look at, and you cannot just simply generalize it. It's God who gives that. This is his blessing. That's the one for the last part of it. But he knows this. When I learn your righteous judgments. That is the word, when I learn. You see, the desire to learn, you know, and this is something we all know. When we have children, they are like sponges, you know, they absorb knowledge like anything. Anything, everything, I want to learn. I had to sort of keep up reading with my little granddaughter. She's a great one. And I'm trying to catch up. Because she knows where the planets are in the solar system. Some of us don't even know what the solar system is. We think, is it, you put your bread inside? Is it, you put it in there, you cook by itself? You're talking microwave. You're not talking. See, people don't know what a microwave is from a solar system. So I had to ask myself, what do I know about the planets? See, I forgot. But she's like a sponge, you just absorb the things here. And I think we all recognize this as we grow older. You know, I'm really thankful for the student pastors. You know, they push me to learn. So I always tell them, I'm just 2 steps away from you. But those are really big steps. But you know what? Because I really want to learn, and I want to see them learn, keep learning. Same here, when I learn, you never take for granted you have learned. You never take for granted. Oh, I memorize. Blessed are the unfathered that they walk in the ways. Blessed are those who seek the commandment, keep the commandment, seek him with the whole heart. I can recite all these verses, but it does not mean I have learned. Doesn't mean that we learn all, and that is an important truth. Pastor Chris will also preach to you. Okay. Hebrews 6, how do I understand this word? You know, and so on Easter Sunday, I explain what the word shall accompany salvation, what that means. And that was a special study that I made, and it, you know, when you learn, there is a special grammatical construction here that does not come out in the English text. And it's wonderful to study, to learn.
to constantly learning, all the time learning, learning. You see, you never take for granted I'm blessed. I have been kept. I have been preserved. God has given me things, but am I really, really blessed? Not safe. You know, Israel was promised all these blessings. Israel never received the fullness of God's blessing. The Lord told them, I will make you. You will be taught, never bottom. Israel was always bottom. You will rule over others. Not they rule over you. They will always rule by others. Instead of gathering them, it was scattered almost utterly. See, we don't realize what a blessing it is. You know what? You need to be blessed. You watch. All your ways directed. You watch. There is a desire to learn. You know, I don't like to read. I am not a reader type. You keep on telling yourself all these things and you continue to be deceived by your own heart, by your own mind, by your own sin. You know, I used to work in prison. And it was a person, and many of the prisoners are very lonely, poorly educated people. They become gangs, they go to primary school, they don't like school, they quarrel with things, they get expelled from school, they join gangs, that's where they feel they belong. They use their strength, they beat up people, and they go to jail. And one of those guys, you know, just doesn't know how to read or write. And one day when I was teaching that, I was like, in math, because they were in a halfway house. And I was one of those people who was helping them to find jobs in the daytime. You know, and he said, can I tell you my testimony? I never liked knowledge. I never thought I could learn. I failed in school and I was kicked out. And even though I say I have a PSLE primary 6, actually I don't know how to read at all. Words confuse me. He says, every day now, I read the scriptures. You see, it's not learning, it's the heart. I want to be, I want to learn, I want to be changed. And they are completely changed. And that's the meaning. And I've seen them change. And I know that this is all God's work. Where? The Word of God. So from here, they transfer over here at the address. Their hearts. And you should hear them sing. Just a small group of guys, and they can sing. You know, it's really, really wonderful to hear them sing. You know why? It's not that you know how to sing, you get a choir. It's the way to sing. It's from the heart that is made righteous. That's good. You know, if something comes out of that, that's the difference. And so you can watch away. So we begin with this particular psalm, this one, eight verses. And this is where this book opens up. He observes. He interprets. He knows God's there. He knows God's word is involved. He applies it into his life. And he says, you know what, but I know where they're. Obviously, he's a reader. Obviously, he's educated. Obviously, he's doing well in terms of skills. But his heart, his life, they're not blessed. Straight away, the instinctive desire is, I want to be blessed. I really, really want to be blessed. And that's what happens. Right? And so I'm really hoping that you will go in and discuss, you know, the next session, take time, talk to each other, relate to each other, and seriously ask, how can I make sense out of God's word? And if you can do that, watch your heart, your mind, your spirit, your attitude, your very life, every aspect of it, then you know you are walking in the path of the blessed. Until then, don't think of it as blessing. The mercies of God, the sun shines on both the good and the wicked. That's all we have, the mercies of God, the faithfulness of God, the grace of God. This is blessing. Watch the Lord's life, watch the Lord's blessing of your life, walk the way He pours His life into us. His words are eternal life, and it brings life into us. Our heart, our mind, our spirit, every part of it we touch into. That's how you know you're saved. Not because you make a, I believe in Jesus Christ. That means nothing. Not everyone who says Lord, Lord, and the heart remains unchanged completely. You see, we fool ourselves. We come up with a formula. You know, I just believe in Jesus Christ. I say the sinner's prayer. I'm okay now. You will wake up on the other side of heaven. That is not true. You want to see a real person, really blessed. Even as he writes the psalm, he knows that he needs to see. This is only the first part. You walk the struggles in his life as he reviews things further. He struggles right up to the 176th verse. He struggles. But at least you know he's struggling. What's the difference between a crocodile and a log? The bird is asked. Before. How do you know? The fruit of the law, the people will know. It looks like a law, but the law will always go downstream. But the crocodile will go upstream, because the law cannot swim. The current will carry the law. The crocodile will swim. That's what it is. You want to know why you're ready or not? There will be a struggle to go after you all the time. You know, the way is to God, after you all the time. And you're just taking it easy, relax, and all this. I can tell you, your ways are not directed to keep our status. Will you be blessed? No. You will only have the mercy of God. That's it. But God designs to bless, not just grant mercy. Be challenged to consider this word. Okay? What a prayer. Our Father, we thank you for the challenge that we know it. Help us to look at the psalm and read the psalm carefully and understand it as we should. We pray that you will teach us how to look at your word and to apply it to our mind rigorously. Because we want to, because it's natural to. We pray for your grace and your mercy. And then, Lord, help us to desire that blessing too. Hear this all prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.